It is now time for Diary of a Wrestling Fan with Bill Chase. And now, here he is, the man who is Dwayne Johnson's acting coach, Bill Chase! Thank you, Mr. Podcast Announcer, and welcome to another episode of Diary of a Wrestling Fan. I am Bill Chase, the podcast that chronicles my 33 amazing years being a fan of professional wrestling, and we got a very extreme episode for you coming up in just a short. But right now, I'd like to give a quick plug to Pro Wrestling Ontario, PWO, of Burlington, Ontario, Canada. Match to match, bell to bell, show to show, you name it, excitement personified. Fast-paced competition from some of the best in the Ontario independent wrestling scene. Check out our YouTube channel. If you're listening to this podcast on YouTube, just scroll your mouse over the video and you'll see the link right there up top. Click on it after the show is over and subscribe. All right, well, before we get this episode underway, also, I just want to say thank you to those who listened to the Summer of Punk episode last week. It is the third most listened to episode thus far on the podcast. Whether you listened on Anchor or Spotify or YouTube, either way. I just put it on YouTube, so not many people listen to it on YouTube. And Anchor, Spotify did some really good numbers with that particular podcast. The third most listened to episode so far on this podcast, behind the debut episode, which chronicled a WWF Superstars taping I attended, and the number one episode thus far, the Benoit tragedy, actually, that I covered. And again, you can check those out in the archive, along with some other great episodes. Please hit that subscribe button on YouTube and follow on Spotify. Just follow me wherever podcasts are streamed and show your support. Well, here we go. We're going to relive the time I discovered that infamous Renegade promotion out of that bingo hall in Philadelphia, PA, ECW. And you know what? I discovered it during its peak, pretty much. Like, it was unlike anything I had ever seen before. But we begin our story in April of 1995. Now, I just finished watching WrestleMania 11. You know, as a kid, as a 12-year-old, this show wasn't bad. Oh, okay, I might take some flack even for saying that, but I enjoyed both the main events. Shawn Michaels and Diesel was fun, but that is the time I found myself starting to like Shawn Michaels. I think that was the goal that Shawn was trying to go for in that match. I don't know. But even the Lawrence Taylor Bam Bam Bigelow match, as I remember watching Lawrence Taylor play football even since I was a little kid, that was exciting too. And I really enjoyed that match as well. The rest of the show I thought was pretty, as a 12-year-old might say, boring. And again, I was still a WWF kid, you know what I mean? I still love the WWF, but let's just say if I taped an episode of Raw or Superstars or whatever other show I was watching, or a pay-per-view even, there's some stuff I'd fast forward, let's just say. And also, there was stuff that I didn't particularly understand. Like, even at that young of an age, I didn't know why every occupation I had learned about in class was a wrestler. You know what I mean? It's like I'm learning about garbage men and even clowns and country music singer. It's nothing against Jeff Jarrett, but still. At this time, I should say Jarrett was actually doing really well with that feud with Razor Ramon. But anyway, I digress. It just seems like every occupation I learned growing up in school, in elementary school, and even in the middle school, as I was in at this time, I was in grade 7. It just seemed like that was all coming onto TV with the WWF, and even WCW to a slightly lesser extent. But I was watching both mainstream promotions at the time, and WCW, I felt, again, and I alluded to this on the NWO episode, which, by the way, you can find in the archives. I thought that WCW just had slightly more interesting things happening. I thought the Hogan-Vader feud was really good. I was really enjoying that, because I always thought Vader was this unstoppable badass, and, you know, Hogan, again, I liked Hogan, and Macho Man was there now, too. And there was still some good stuff happening in both promotions, even as a kid. But I felt like they could have been doing so much. Even as 12 years old, I was playing Fantasy Booker. You know what I mean? I was playing, like, you know, the matches I wanted to see. The interpromotional card I'd always booked between WWF and WCW for supremacy, you know what I mean? And I don't know. I just felt as if they could use an extra spark. You know, in the mid-90s, you know, the way the culture was at this point, you know, you just had millions upon millions of people, higher audiences than the Super Bowl, watching the trial of, coincidentally, a football legend, O.J. Simpson. And that whole ordeal took the world that I lived in anyway by storm. All of North America, and even from what I heard overseas, was paying attention to what they called the trial of the century. And yet here I am, you know, just trying to survive grade 7. I mean, I was not a very popular kid in middle school, to say the least. Even the group of friends I had didn't always act like good friends. But again, being kids, that stuff sort of happens. There were a few people in my class who enjoyed wrestling, but I mainly still enjoyed partaking in this stuff with my cousins. But even at this time, it seems like 1995 was even a year that a lot of the most diehard wrestling fans kind of took a break. And even though my cousins were watching still at this point, they weren't as enthusiastic about it. I mean, they'd actually be more enthusiastic in 1996 about things. I don't know. And honestly, I think the large part of it, and I remember having, you know, these discussions with my cousins in the past, during this time, they point out how, well, it sucks Bret Hart's not the champion. Oh, Bret Hart should be the champion. The Undertaker should be the champion. I like Diesel, but, you know, I don't think he deserves that. Like, that's pretty much what we were saying. I like Diesel, too. I said this. But I think we all could have used an alternative. Yeah, and again, I use that word alternative, and it may be an overused term, but it's true. But back then, the alternative movement, not just in, you know, wrestling were things happening, little did I know yet, but they were happening. Of course, the alternative rock movement, you know, in music, it was happening everywhere. Even television was becoming different. Movies were changing. Everything, the culture was changing among entertainment and everything around us. The mid-90s were a very, I don't want to say odd or even difficult, but just a very, again, I was 12 years old, how difficult could it be? But a very whimsical time, I guess you could say. I don't know. I mean, you had movies like again, Shawshank Redemption came out in 94. You know, it was a movie that did not do well in the box office, but by 1995, by Oscar season, everyone's talking about it. Yeah, and again, like I mean, and if even Forrest Gump, you have these movies that were game changers, changing the landscape of film. We're only a year removed from the death of Kurt Cobain and the significant impact that had. And even television, Friends. During this time, Friends was still in its first season. And to me, Friends was, the concept of Friends at that time, you know, to me, I just thought it was a funny sitcom with a bunch of adults. But really, in hindsight, obviously, the first season, even you can probably say, so for the second, really tried to capture a positive vibe of Generation X. And obviously, I didn't know anything about that at the time. But it's amazing the things you can see with hindsight. You know, again, I digress back to movies, Clerks, the movie Clerks, Kevin Smith. Again, independent filmmaking, heavily influential film in terms of filmmakers. Quentin Tarantino, maybe the most influential director of his era, maybe one of the most influential directors of all time. You know, Pulp Fiction. We're not too far removed from Pulp Fiction. People were looking for something different than the norm in 1995. Because movies like Pulp Fiction, movies like Clerks, even Shawshank were different. Have we heard a band quite like Nirvana before or since? The Foo Fighters made their entry into music. Dave Grohl's would just seem like a side project. 1995. Films like Clueless, like again, captured a generation. And even at my age, I wasn't particularly looking for anything different, but I was loving the way the world was becoming. All this great stuff before my eyes and ears. But wrestling had to do something. And, you know, hey, not everything is a winner even in sports. The CFL, was smack dab in their horrendous American expansion project, the NHL was moving into the neutral zone trap system, which many in hindsight found to be the most boring era of professional hockey. Me? I was just loving hockey still. In basketball, at this time, we were only... I think Michael Jordan had just really started to come out of retirement. After he had been gone for nearly 2 years. So that gives you pretty much an idea of how the world was in 1995. And here I am just trying to survive being picked on every day. And then one night, not long after WrestleMania 11, I discovered something that I just could not believe. Now, I often bought issues of Pro Wrestling Illustrated back when I was this age. I bought almost every wrestling magazine that was available because my grandmother at the time was working at the GO station, the GO Transit station here in Hamilton. And they had a newsstand. She would work the newsstand sometimes. And she would save all the wrestling magazines for me. Whether it was WWF, WCW, or PWI, anything, any of the aftermags. And so I had heard about ECW, and I knew that some guys that I remember watching on WWF or WCW were there as well. There were also these guys I had never heard of. So even though I read about it, it didn't really register with me. And I thought this stuff, the pictures looked cool, like the hardcore stuff looked cool, the blood and everything. Again, I'm 12 years old. Again, this is an era, too, where action movies are still a rage. And one night in the spring of 1995, it was a weekend, and we got this station in Pennsylvania for part of our cable package. Now, I know ECW's programming didn't, I don't think it normally aired on weekends, but I guess this station aired it on the weekend, I suppose. And I do one of those things where I blatantly try to stay up all night. Not like never sleep, I mean, just like stay up to like, you know, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock. And because there would be times where my parents would be asleep downstairs in the basement, the rec room, and not in their room, which is on the same floor, my old house on Lawfield Drive. So one night, I have my TV on low because I don't want to have it up too loud. And I'm flicking channels. There's nothing on. Old reruns of like 70 sitcoms, which I liked, but I was trying to find, you know, maybe something different to watch. And as I'm flicking the channels, I see this montage of wrestling. So I stop. I'm like, wait a minute, this isn't WWF or WCW. And I'm thinking to myself, well, what is this? And then I'm seeing some names I recognize. I see Ron Simmons, who I remember from WCW. I'm like, well, that's where he went. I'm seeing Too Cold Scorpio, who I also remember from WCW. So I'm seeing guys that are familiar. Then the big shock I had gotten, Cactus Jack. I loved him in WCW. And I had wondered what happened to him after he lost his Loser Leaves WCW match to Kevin Sullivan. But then I'm seeing all these characters like Axel and Ian Rotten and the Pitbulls and guys I'd never heard of. Shane Douglas, who I'd remembered from WCW. And then I'm thinking, I'm going to stay with this, but much to my chagrin, the show was almost over. But then I saw someone who just blew me away. A character by the name of Raven. Raven cut a promo on Tommy Dreamer. And Raven also had this beautiful woman named Beulah McGillicuddy with him. And Raven's brooding personality, calling out this almost like jock-like figure, this man who supposedly, you know, like almost like bullied him when they were younger, it seemed. You know, the story of the summer camp and the girl, you know, it's insane that even at the age of 12, for some reason, I could not forget about Raven, even as the show was about to end. This aired at 3 in the morning, it seemed, and by it was about 4 o'clock, the show ended. So I made it my goal the next week to stay awake. But then there was something that happened. I was supposed to have a sleepover with my cousins that weekend. So I did have a VCR in my room and a television, of course, obviously. And I programmed the VCR to that same station, 3 a.m. Now, even at this age, I'm skeptical that maybe this is just a one-time thing. It might not air the next week, because I've had the disappointment in the past with other TV programming that one week it's there, the next week it's not. But after that sleepover, I got home and checked the tape, and there it was. ECW. Extreme Championship Wrestling. And there's this very enthusiastic looking announcer, Joey Styles, throwing to the show. And we see a great montage. We see Raven and Tommy Dreamer. And imagine again, Raven, I'm for something about this guy. I didn't know what it was. And I kind of got the idea Raven was a bad guy. You know, a heel, but still, back then, good guys, bad guys, that's what it was. Raven's a bad guy. I didn't like bad guys. I hated them. I hated all of them. Some of them I found entertaining and enjoyed watching, but never cheered for them, never rooted for them. But I'm wanting Raven to beat up Tommy Dreamer. Why? Because for some reason, Tommy Dreamer reminded me of all the guys that used to pick on me. Now, I actually didn't know at the time Beulah had just debuted. And they were showing clips of her spraying Tommy Dreamer with hairspray. And then I remember seeing this guy named Eddie Guerrero face Too Cold Scorpio. And the stuff they were doing was ridiculous. I was hooked. I used the same junk tape over and over to tape episodes of ECW for the next few weeks. I was loving the hardcore wrestling. I love the Pitbulls. I became a fan of the Pitbulls. I became a fan of Public Enemy. I hated Cactus Jack again after liking him in WCW. And even though as much as I loved Raven, I couldn't stand Stevie Richards. And I'm seeing these matches, I'm seeing the stuff with Dreamer and Raven week after week. I'm watching the Tasmaniac. I thought this guy was so cool. Cactus Jack feuding with Terry Funk. I remember Terry Funk from all the tapes I used to watch that I rented from Jumbo Video. I also seen his movies like Paradise Alley, the work he's done with Stallone. And I remember the flaming branding iron that Funk brought to the ring and tried to burn Foley with, and the promo that Cactus cut after. Oh my goodness. So after weeks of not saying much to my friends or even my cousins, I told them, I said, guys, you gotta check out this wrestling show, ECW. Now, I kept meaning to bring the tape, but here's the thing. Obviously, at my young age, I could tell ECW was geared to an older audience. Now, I was allowed to watch some R-rated films, like mainly action pictures and whatnot, and even comedy's a lot of swearing. The only rule was you just don't repeat what you say, or sorry, repeat what you hear in those movies. And we never did when our parents were around. But and of course, with women like Beulah around, who's had no problems showing off what she had, we figured it wouldn't be an appropriate product to ask our parents if we could watch. So we never could find the time to watch it. But even so, it seemed as though they weren't overly excited about it. At the time, my cousin Wayne was almost 10, but Corey and Mike were still pretty young. I think they were only about 7 at this point. Jamie was a bit older at the age of 13, but he didn't really have any interest in it. Neither did my friend Adam Pryor, who is a wrestling fan, or was a wrestling fan at that time. He didn't particularly have any interest in it either. I thought I was kind of not disappointed, but I was kind of a little downtrodden that nobody wanted to watch this with me. I felt so alone. So for the longest time, I taped this week after week, enjoying everything. And I'm seeing like Marty Jannetty popping up, like, oh, hey, there he is. And this guy 911, who I thought was just the coolest. I thought 911 was the coolest. Just came and choke slam whoever. I love this guy. The Sandman. Now the Sandman, I hate it. I hated the Sandman. You know why? I didn't understand if he was a good guy or a bad guy. I didn't get it. Maybe because of being so young, I don't know. And it didn't occur to me who or what he was. So. But I did enjoy watching him. He was unique. I didn't know where Shane Douglas got all his charisma from suddenly after watching him at WCW. I'm like, oh, who'd thought this guy's exciting? So it was something to truly behold, and I loved watching Raven and his cronies get the best of Tommy Dreamer every week. Raven was the first heel I was ever a fan of. That is why ECW is definitely an important time in my life. And even though I was nothing like Raven personality-wise, it's almost as if I wanted to be in a way. I wanted to be this brooding, miserable individual who said these insane yet wonderful things in my head. It's like I wanted to be a part of his flock, follow him around, and get revenge on all the people that wronged me. I had a lot of built-up anger when I was younger because, again, I'm not trying to paint myself as a victim here. I got through it. So no point in saying that, but let's just say thank God social media wasn't around at this time, because I don't know how I would have survived it. Every day was a challenge at school. I struggled with schoolwork, even though I tried my hardest many times. The people, the bullies, everybody just had something to say to me, try to wind me up, try to pick on me, try to get on my case. The only ones that were really had my back, even 110%, were two teachers, and that was homeroom or advisor teacher. Better known as homeroom teacher, Mrs. Johnston, and my gym/health teacher, Mr. Satino. And I wouldn't have gone through middle school without them. I would not have gone through anything without them during that era. So you can imagine me wanting to walk into school wearing cutoff jeans, a music shirt of one of my favorite bands, a leather coat, and a plaid shirt tied around my waist, and just give everybody a scowl. Give them a look through my eyes that'll strike fear into them. Quote the Raven, "Nevermore." Sorry, I had to. but no, and I kept raving. No, that's not a pun, believe me. I kept raving to my friends about Raven. But I guess when you're a kid, you don't always describe things the way you want them to come out. I still have that problem these days, too, when I'm doing a podcast. But I'm much better than I was. But at the same time, though, at the age of 12, you're trying to explain this character, and they just don't get it. It's not their fault. Maybe had they discovered ECW by accident like I had, or actually watched it, they might have gotten something wrong. But then again, maybe not. I learned as time goes on, everybody's going to like what you're going to like. At that time, of course, age of 12, everybody should like what I like. Because I like good stuff. And it was, it sucked that my friends weren't exactly enjoying this whole thing. They weren't even checking it out. So, week after week, for the next several months, even as things are getting exciting, in July, we have a house fire. I'm going to go deeper into this on another episode when I talk about In Your House 2 one of these days. And basically what happened was there was a kitchen fire that started by accident when my mother was cooking my father fries. The pot was old, but yeah, it was still always cooked my dad's fries perfectly, so we kept it. And just it suddenly caught on fire. This fire spread through the kitchen fast. Our cupboards were old. They caught on fire real quick. Our whole kitchen was damaged. That was it, really. It was mainly just the kitchen, plus our floors, plus smoke damage. That wasn't too severe, but we had to dry clean every bit of clothing or fabric we had in the house. Thankfully, we had insurance that covered everything. But those few weeks there, between late July and mid-August, things were rough. I couldn't watch ECW. I was wondering week after week, because I would stay at my aunt's, I would stay at my grandmother's. They didn't get that station. I'm like, damn it. And I believe it was just before this time, just before all this happened, that, the gangsters were coming in. New Jack and Mustafa. And seeing these guys, and hearing the things they were saying, I'm like, oh my God. Like, again, I'm only 12, but still. Even I'm thinking in my head, can they say that? Can they do that? New Jack and Mustafa completely blew me away. And of course, I love Public Enemy, and the gangsters being the bad guys, no, I want Public Enemy to kick their ass. So I was missing this week after week because I was so intrigued. I was wondering what else Raven was doing with Tommy Dreamer. I was wondering what new ways he was trying to get under his skin, or The other things Raven was doing is getting involved with the group called the Dudley Boys. My first exposure to the Dudleys. Even before Devon was around. Another one, I was really getting into Mikey Whipwreck. I love little Mikey Whipwreck. So, finally, by August, everything was pretty much back to normal, mid-August or so. We had the VCR back in the room again. None of the electronics got damaged during this whole thing. Like I said, it was just our kitchen, but still, I wasn't allowed to stay at the house for a while. And finally, I was able to see Public Enemy hopefully getting their revenge on the gangsters. And that whole ordeal where they invited all the fans in the ring, and that's when the ring imploded. I finally watched to see that just in time. It was so good. So once again, I was back to watching ECW every week. Nobody really, other than me, caring about it. And actually, I gotta correct myself, because earlier I said in this podcast I was in grade 7 at the time. I was actually in grade 6 when I started watching ECW. I was about to enter grade 7 now at this point. And so now you can imagine my surprise when Shane Douglas becomes Dean Douglas. I recognized him right away. It's not like he changed the look all that much. He just put on a pair of glasses and was dressed like a teacher. So I was a little surprised to see that. And as time went on, as invested I was getting in the product, I'm thinking, you know what? I want Raven to be champion. He should be the champion. As I kept saying over and over, Raven should be champion. Should beat the Sandman. And grade 7 was just as hard as grade 6 to go through. But either way, Raven was giving me hope. So, I think it was shortly after New Year's. I think it was early in 1996. Still, yeah, it was. It finally happened. Raven became the champion. I watched it on tape the next day on a Sunday. I jumped off of my bed in excitement, hitting the floor to the point where my mom's yelling, "What's going on?" I just told her I fell. And almost wanted to yell at the top of my lungs that Raven was the champ. Like, in your face, Sandman. In your face. And also, even just before this, I remember loving the stuff Steve Austin was doing. I watched him for years as Stunning Steve in WCW. And I thought the hilarious stuff he was doing, the whole Monday Night love that. And again, I was in awe. You know what I mean? I'm like, this guy's funny. Why was he not like that? Again, why was he not like this in WCW, I said. And I started liking heels more. I started liking the bad guys a bit. I even thought Cactus Jack was amusing. So, as things progress, another big moment. I remember watching the WWF. He was Superstars. And there's Steve Austin. They're calling him the Ringmaster. He was boring again. He was absolutely boring. I didn't mind him as Stunning Steve, but again, he was a bad guy. I hated him. WCW. So, Steve Austin's boring again. There we go. Thankfully, that didn't last. yeah. But the next big thing I remember coming up was I was watching the Super Brawl pay-per-view, Super Brawl 6, WCW. I remember Brian Pillman, Kevin Sullivan, they were feuding for weeks on Nitro. Because again, the Monday Night Wars are well underway at this point. But I'm still into ECW. And what happens? Brian Pillman says, I respect you, Booker man. Again, I'm pushing 13 years old at this point. I have no idea what the hell he's talking about. None whatsoever. Booker man, what? I was watching that pay-per-view with my cousin Jeffrey, and I looked at him like, what did he mean? Of course, neither of us knew. Booker, man. So, not long after, again, I tape another episode of ECW, and there's Pillman. I'm like, oh my goodness, no way. And I love Pillman. I loved Pillman. I didn't like him when he turned bad. he only turned heel. In fall of 1995 when he joined the Four Horsemen. So, he wasn't healed for too long, but I still loved him. I thought, this is going to be great. I suddenly love Pillman again. And I heard about the car wreck, which I thought was terrible. So, again, I got to see some amazing moments. And it changed my perception of wrestling. Because you know what I thought? Again, being a kid, I'm just like, why can't WWF and WCW be more like this? That's exactly what I thought. Of course, at that time, I don't know that this sort of stuff ECW was doing how it would translate to a wide audience. It might not. But, obviously, mainly the WWF would, you know, use some of the elements that made ECW successful. I'm not saying they, you know, some could use Vince Russo blatantly stealing. Maybe he did, maybe he didn't. I don't know. It's hard to believe Vince Russo, even if his tongue is notarized, but like, it's hard to say. Either way, ECW clearly had an influence on the business, on the wrestling game, and it would show with the Attitude Era. Even some of the stuff WCW was doing, some of it. Not a lot, but little bits here and there, you could see ECW had a big influence. So again, I fast forward a bit more here. Again, I'm 13 years old. I'm still trying to survive middle school. But again, Raven is that guy giving me hope. And then he loses the title. That fall, I'm like, no! I was so upset. And then something unthinkable happens. It's around the same time. Raven brainwashes Sandman's son. I thought this was incredible. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. Or sorry, no, this was, yeah, actually the brainwashing of the sun was just before Raven lost the title. And things are getting really, really good. I am enjoying this feud. And I'm thinking to myself, this is awesome. This is amazing. Raven is such... I thought Raven had more power than The Undertaker. That's how much I love this guy. And I think of the stuff that they were saying about Sandman, everything. It is true. He is a pathetic drunk. Again, as a fan, this is what I'm thinking. And again, like I said, I didn't like Sandman. I'm like, good. This kid's with someone who cares about him. Again, like I said, I'm 12. Give me a break, people. I'm 12. Because, yeah, Raven started a thing with Sandman's ex, and that was how it all went. I was loving it. So, like I said, we fast-forwarded a bit here. And the crucifixion happened. For those of you listening to this, you might already know what I'm talking about. So, I'm watching this one episode of ECW where it looked like Tyler, who's Sandman's son, and Sandman had reunited. This is in October 96. It's just for Halloween, I remember. And Raven attacks. He hits the DDT, and the show goes off the air. And then, also on the show, I saw a guy by the name of Kurt Angle, who I remember watching his gold medal ceremony, the Olympics, that summer. And again, I didn't really think about him again for another couple of years. So, as it happened, I'm thinking, cool. Raven, You know, he's going to take back the title soon. I can't wait. Because Raven at this point seemed like just a defeated man. And then I go to tape it the next week. It's gone. It was something else, some other program. I can't remember what it was. Actually, you know what? I think it might have been a rerun of Three's Company, which is a show I like, but I'm like, where's ECW? I tried again the next week. It was gone still. I'm like, what the hell? I was getting pissed. I didn't know the crucifixion had happened. It didn't air. And I'm wondering, I'm like, why is it gone suddenly? I had no clue that this had happened. None. And then I went to the house of a friend of mine, a fellow by the name of Dave, who lived around the corner. He was a frenemy. He was a frenemy, shall we say. And he had the internet. I didn't. So we're watching some random, you know, wrestling videos that take about half an hour to download, even longer. And one of the things he showed me was not a video, but a picture, actually. We were just watching like random videos of stuff we've seen before. And I was like, oh, this internet thing's cool. This was about 3-4 months after ECW stopped airing. I hadn't seen it. And it was close to the time now where it's just right around this time where Paul Heyman and ECW are invading the WWF, sort of. Which I thought was awesome. I'm like, this is freaking amazing. Now, I'd been reading in Pro Wrestling Illustrated for a couple months. I saw Raven got the title back, which I thought was cool. Like, I want to watch. Where is this? And then what happens? One of the wrestling websites we go to? It might have been the Raja WWF site. I don't know. But it was one of them, and I see a picture of the Sandman crucified. Then there's a bit of a text below it saying how it caused a lot of controversy. And I'm like, wow. And I'm thinking, wait a minute. Was that the same night where Tyler looked like he was reuniting with? And I saw the date, and it was pretty much around the time I watched that show, that episode. It made sense. Clearly, this was a religion. Like, again, I didn't know much about religion. Like, I did, because my mom had a very spiritual side. I knew about Jesus. I knew about, you know, the crucifixion, you know, all that, a lot of that stuff. I knew the basics, pretty much. I wasn't offended, obviously, but it kind of made me scratch my head. I'm like, I was just more like puzzled by it, or, you know, reading a bit about it. And like, okay, that kind of sucks. So I'm not going to see ECW anymore. So I remember watching the invasion on Raw. That was in February. It was actually literally almost like, I think a couple weeks after I saw the whole thing about this picture of the Sandman crucified and reading the text and that. And then I see ECW on Raw, and I see Raven saunter down the ringside, and I'm like, yes, and he didn't really do anything. What? I read PWI to keep up with what was going on with ECW. And as time went on, I just kind of, here's the thing, WCW was hot with the NWO. WWF was getting better. You know, the whole Hart Foundation thing was about to begin, and the feud with Bret and Stone Cold was amazing. Undertaker was about to become champion. There was some good stuff happening, great stuff even, on both brands of WWF and WCW. So I didn't forget about ECW, but it wasn't like I was suffering without it. But then when I'm watching WCW, I'm watching Nitro. This is around summer is beginning. I just graduated grade 8. So I'm watching Nitro. I'm actually with a couple of my cousins at the time. And I was paying attention, but when they were over, it could be easily distracting because we're trying to do something else, right? And we're still watching the show, though. And I'm looking over, and I hear the commentators say, it's Raven. I'm like, I turn around, and I'm like, what? And there he is in the crowd, and I jump to my feet. My cousins are wondering what I'm so excited about. I'm like, he's in WCW. I was so excited. They could not care less. So as time went on, I was excited to see Raven in WCW. Always enjoyed his character. So I enjoyed the fact that I could watch him on television every week. Even though I wish he would just get out of the crowd and wrestle. I didn't know he had injury issues at the time, but he'd wrestle occasionally and whatnot, the Ravens rules stuff, holding out for the contract, stuff like that. Again, that's why it went on so long, because I guess he wasn't 100% yet. But once he started wrestling every week, pretty much, it was great, great stuff. I was really enjoying his feud with like Benoit and DDP. You know, I thought that was some excellent stuff. The feud with Saturn he'd have later on. And the losing streak thing, which started off promising, and then he kind of became a baby face, which is strange. I just never thought that character should ever be a good guy. But I still enjoyed watching him. And as time went on, though, I got in touch with ECW again in 1998 when I met a tape trader in grade 9 in high school. And he had made these compilation tapes, and he would let me borrow them and sometimes buy them. And I was queued up with ECW again. And I was excited by guys like Rob Van Dam now. And I thought he was really cool. I'm like, this Rob Van Dam guy is freaking awesome. This Just Incredible guy is, he's a wrestler. I'm just kidding. Kind of. But yeah, all these like new talents are coming in. I was enjoying them. But then the tape trader, who I had known for about a year, right up until 1999, kind of moved away. So I was still getting some good ECW content, but it didn't feel the same. I didn't say I didn't enjoy it. It didn't feel the same. But again, I got excited when ECW was moving to TNN. I'm thinking, great, I can watch it every week. I love the Dudleys. I thought they were very highly entertaining. They were assholes, but I thought they were great. Dreamer, I started to like Dreamer. I did. I hated him for a while, obviously, because of the Raven view, but I started to like Dreamer. Still never liked Sammy, even though he was in WCW around this time as Hack. I didn't like him in WCW either. I was just never a big Sandman fan. I don't know. I mean, I appreciate what he's done, like, you know what I mean, but still, just as at the time, just never a mark for the guy. And then ECW debuts in TNN. I'm loving the stuff with RVD and Jerry Lynn. Again, come full circle. Raven returns as Tommy Dreamer's partner, the man he loathes. And the man who loathes him equally, if not even more, the Beat the Dudley boys who've made it clear they're heading to the WWF and putting the belts on Vince McMahon's table or his desk. And they were the Dudleys not long after that, even right around that time, around the exact same time. And I jumped out of my chair again when Raven held Dreamer, and they became the tag champions. So that's my journey of ECW. I hope you all enjoyed it. It was a good trip down memory lane of a company that, again, I thought the world of, because it was just so different. And then I did notice the elements that WWF was getting a little more extreme, but not obviously to that full point. But still, you can see it had an impact on the wrestling landscape that it still felt to this very day. So, once again, thank you all for joining me. Again, like I said, if you're listening to this on YouTube, hit that subscribe button. Thank you for listening on Anchor or Spotify, if that's where or wherever podcasts are streamed. Please follow on Spotify if you are listening on that format. Also, letting you know that there are other projects I'm working on in the future for podcasts, so stay tuned for that as well. Next week on Diary of a Wrestling Fan, going back to my young days at the age of 9, and Dick the Snake Roberts in WCW. It's going to be an interesting one for sure. It was a short yet fairly memorable run that he had there, feuding with the man called Sting. So, yeah, I didn't have to, but I wanted to. So once again, thank you all for joining me. And so until next time, this has been Diarrhea Wrestling Fan, easy for me to say. And I am Bill Chase, quoting a great Hamiltonian man when I say, don't you dare miss it. Thank you for listening to Diary of a Wrestling Fan with Bill Chase. If you'd like to make a contribution to the show, Anyone out there who knows Don Callis, please talk him into being Bill's co-host.